All right, here we go. I am simulcasting right now. This video of me here talking is being recorded direct to disk, so there's no dropout problem with the wireless connection, which is very, very erratic. And I'm also broadcasting this to Ustream, but I can't have the video camera on both sources at once, both programs at once. So I'm using a background of this Now Is Concurrent with Time, Nicholas Rohr at Course in Miracles background, and this should be the audio should be there on this. It looks like it is. So we'll see how that works. I don't know if the video will probably freeze up at some point, knowing how the technology is so very buggy. So anyway, that way is on both Ustream and YouTube, both. And I have a backup in case the wireless connection drops out. I have a straight to disk here, and I'll be able to upload it. All right, the cat is now here, so I guess the satsang can begin. And it's very important. This is Christ clarity, reassurance. Reassurance means to reassure that what we're trying to do is possible. We're trying to find true happiness, not fake happiness, true happiness. And it is possible. There's no question it's possible. The spiritual path is really about finding your mistakes, because if we don't have true happiness, which is bliss, then definitely we're making a huge mistake, and we have to find out how are we making this mistake or mistakes, and become aware of it. So today, as usual, I was just trying to dig a little deeper and take a closer look. And I saw something, and it was, colossal and super important. And the reaction is, I just said, oh, okay, that's very interesting. Just like that. No emotional reaction, no nothing, just that's very interesting. Let me just look at that, just look at it. But I knew it was like all important, but still, it's better if you just stay calm, objective, witness it, look at it, and say, okay, I see that. I see it. What it was is I realized that I have been trying to be ahead in time, and in this sort of advanced time situation, be able to try and make things better before they're experienced here in this world. I'm aware of things like a couple days before they happen, and sometimes a lot more. And I try to do things to make things better in the world, so the time of events that are coming are not so severe. But of course, this essentially requires me to shoulder the burdens, everything that's coming in the world, shoulder all those burdens and try desperately to try and reduce the intensity of them all. So it creates just incredible, impossible stress. And I saw this. I saw that. I said, oh yeah, okay, that's what I've been doing. Okay, which of course is not salvation. It's not the answer at all. The answer is, again, to abide in the self, abide in the overlay, abide in bliss, abide in the perfect and eternal, flawless blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Abide in that. So you're not even concerned about whatever happens in the world. That has no effect on your happiness at all. So you're not shouldering any burden. You're not trying to change anything that's coming down the road in experience in this world. What's coming down the road is absolutely terrible. And the idea of being aware of it ahead of time, which is what I have tried to do in justice a little bit, and then try and fix it before it gets here, is an unbelievably stressful, suffering life. And it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't work at all. And so it's better to do what works. What works is to, again, that's what we've been talking about, is to accept that The only problem we have is a continuity problem, and the way the continuity problem is solved is through, let me move this over, is by accepting the overlay, the unconditional, all hypotheticals.
Everything like that, but we'll keep trying. So, if we're suffering, we're making a mistake, fundamental mistake. That's a fact. We just have to accept that. If we are suffering, we are making a fundamental mistake. We are trying to help the world by trying to mitigate what the play of Maya, what's happening, instead of just being accepting God's non-judgment upon all Maya, the dance of duality. That's the answer. Accepting God, the Prime Creator's non-judgment upon the dance of duality is the answer. Not trying to manipulate the dance of duality so it's not so severe. That's not the answer. That's what doesn't work. So, really, if we're suffering, that we're trying to somehow manipulate the effects of this dream, which is the mistake. That's the mistake. What we need to do is don't worry about whatever takes place. Let whatever takes place in the world, let it take place. But you are experiencing the perfect non-judgment upon not only what takes place now, but what anything could ever take place in dreams. You're experiencing flawless, perfect, seamless bliss. That's the answer. That's why they say, go within. The answer is within. That's how they try to show it. For instance, like, let's say you were the sun, the solar sun, and within the sun, all was steady. And on the surface, though, everything's just like completely explosive and wild and choppy. Or you can use like the ocean. You're the ocean, and underneath the surface, it's all smooth and calm and peaceful. On the surface, it's all choppy. Well, the answer isn't to try and calm the chop down and tell people about the waves that are coming and the storms that are coming so they can sidestep the storms. The answer is to go beneath the surface of the ocean and experience the peace and calm beneath the surface. That's the answer. And we've been told that over and over again, but we have to see it for ourselves, the mistake that we're making. We have to see it, say, ah, okay, so that's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing. I'm making a mistake, which is great. That's the spiritual path, is to see it, that you're making a mistake. The ones who don't see it will keep on making it. When you see you're making a mistake, then you're willing to accept the correction. Say, oh, okay, I see what I'm doing wrong, and so now let me correct it. Whereas if you don't see it, you'll say, well, I don't need any correction. What are you talking about? I'm not making any mistake. So you avoid the correction that way. So, and don't think you have to correct the mistake instantly. Just notice it. You say, okay, I see it. Okay, I see it. And then if you can remain calm about it and not get all frantic, then you can say, okay, seeing this mistake doesn't cause me any problems. It's very important when you get the insight and see it, just don't do anything about it. Just look at it, see it, notice it, and say, okay, I see it. Don't try to fix it. Don't try to block it, deny it. Don't react to it. Or don't say, wow, I've got it. I finally saw that. Now just stay smooth and calm within the flow of your life. And then later you'll say, hey, you know what? There's no problem seeing that because I was able to remain calm and smooth in my life, no problem at all. So I can see it again, or I can accept the correction to it, of it. So, just because you have a profound insight, that doesn't mean that you have to be all unsettled by it in one way or the other. No, not true. Even if you get a glimpse into bliss, you can just stay calm. Say, okay, I saw a glimpse into bliss, okay. All right, that's fine. Not a problem. And it doesn't inspire you to go run a marathon or climb a mountain
are go downtown and start yelling, going in, into all the restaurants and bars and congregation, place of congregation, and start open the door and yell at everybody, "Hey, everybody, I'm enlightened. I finally saw bliss. I know it's there. You guys, come on out. I'll tell you about it." No. Or you don't go running in all the churches, temples, and synagogues and mosques, etc., saying, coming in, "Hey, everybody," when they're having, you know, their service, "I know the truth. I know the truth. I can set you free. You're going to be free. I know it." You know. No, you don't do that. You don't do that. You don't go into depression. You don't go say, "Oh my God, I got to write a book. I got to write a 200-page book right now. If I don't write it right now, my life is going to be ruined. I got to share this immediately." See, all those things are continuity issues, right? Continuity issues. You know, we're afraid we might do something that is totally non-continuous, a discontinuity, something that's a discontinuity. And so we hold back. But if we just see the insight, the clarity, and see what needs to be seen, and we just remain calm, say, "Okay, saw that, see it, I see it, that's good. Very interesting, okay." Then you say, "Oh, there's no continuity issue, you see? No continuity issue." So that's very important. I believe there's something like in the Zen, what do they call it, dojos or something they call it. The Zen master is walking around, and somehow they know when someone gets a breakthrough, you know, and someone has a breakthrough, they say, "Oh my gosh, hey, and the Zen master has a stick of whack, "Get back to your practice, you know." But master, I saw the truth, whack, you know. "Get back to your practice." Okay. So, it's like that. The traditions that seem to have worked best are those that the people are trained to remain calm under all circumstances and maintain a flow of your functioning, just like always, even though you've now, you know, you've recognized the truth, you've recognized that you've seen it. Because it's not necessarily going to stay with you permanently right off the bat, because you're still dealing with a continuity issue. You're not sure how you're going to function. So if you can keep on functioning smoothly, then you're not so frightened for it to return, you see. So I'm telling you, the continuity issue is the number one issue. And these are minor continuity issues. The big one is, how do we set down hypotheticals altogether? And that's by experience abiding in bliss. That actually does it. So you cannot necessarily tell how much insight someone has, because if they've gone far along the path, it's almost for sure that they're calm and they could have an incredible insight and see the whole thing, and just still, you wouldn't be able to tell any difference in their expression or anything. You have no idea. Oftentimes I get it while I'm driving a car. I have this amazing breakthrough, and I just say, "Well, I just got to keep driving. got no option. I can't pull over the side road and jump, get out and start jumping up and down. I got to just, oh, there's some traffic there. You know, wow, why is that guy coming up fast on my left? And oh, here comes emerging cars. I got to get over. You know, and you just keep on driving. But meanwhile, you're going woo 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 woo, like wow." So it's important to keep up the flow of your life, flow of your functionality. Don't try and function differently. Which is why the Zen stories are like, you see a gardener, someone just raking the leaves up, cleaning the leaves up, and taking care of the trash, or was it, you know, taking care of all the dead stuff, trash, and they've been doing that for, you know, 10 years, and they're always the same. Every day they're the same. They think, wow, that poor guy, you know, he's just having to do this task, same task day after day, just no excitement in his life, and wow. And then one day, you know, he's introduced as the new abbot of the monastery, whatever, however they say it, and how's that possible? Well, because this one was actually having tremendous breakthroughs, but they were just practicing staying in the flow of functionality as they were having the breakthrough. So as they're raking up the leaves, they may be seeing very clearly, like, wow, you know, God's perfect non-judgment on all hypotheticals is the answer. And I can see how I've been trying to actually deal with hypotheticals by manipulating time and trying to get into the future ahead of time. And then, you know, you can see that I'm seeing this, but meanwhile they're just raking the leaves, and they pick up the trash, and they put the trash in here in the can or something, they carry the trash, and they're just taking the trash out all the time. And everybody just assumes that they're a low person on the totem pole. They're you know, failures, but it's just the opposite. As a matter of fact, the insights are so profound that they really need to be doing something like that that engages their attention. That's very true. Very, very true. The further you go along, the less you react to the big insights that come your way. And you go faster because of that. You go much, much faster, and the path gets much, much smoother. So make sure to practice that. Make sure to practice that. Is you tell yourself, okay, I'm not going to react one way or the other. I'm not one way or the other. I'm just going to look. I'm just looking. I'm just looking. I want to see. I want to see what the mistakes I'm making are. I'm just going to look at them, and that's it. I'm just going to look. I'm not going to write them down. I'm not going to, you know, publicize them. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. And you have to be very disciplined in that way. Usually in these videos, the insights will flow, and I'll have insights I've never even seen before. Like the last video I did was amazing. I was just watching, kind of listening to myself talk and saying, wow. I was able to just stay, you know, stay pretty calm about it and just listen. So that's an example. As an example of that, where you have, you know, just amazing insights. You say, oh my gosh, I understand this hugely important aspect of what's going on, and you just say, okay, I understand it, I've seen it, okay, interesting, and just keep going on smoothly. Now, of course, there are some who do it backwards. There's always some. The ego tell people to do it backwards, of course. Always, always, always. So there's some who intentionally cultivate this kind of quiet, calm demeanor, smooth demeanor. And then, as if to then say, well, that must mean that they're having these great insights. You know, that's putting it, you know, it's frozen up. Both feeds have frozen up.
Okay, well, it's back. Oh, well, it's back. Wow. Phew. It's really a problem, isn't it? It's technology.
And again, don't overreact to that. Just stay calm within the functioning. So we can really notice what we're doing wrong. We can notice the answer to it. We can notice it. We can notice it. And we may have actually already have noticed it quite a few times. I know I have. And I just wonder, wow, what do I have to do? What do I have to do? But the noticing of it is probably dealing with a continuity issue. There's the belief that when you accept God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals and you experience bliss, that you will suddenly have a completely different life and act in ways that are totally different than what you've acted before and all this kind of stuff. And that's a real obstacle. That's what I've experienced. One of the worst things you can do is to imagine how you would function when you're blissful. I tried to avoid that at all costs because I used to do that a lot, and I could tell it was blocking me, because I can imagine just an incredible life for myself and helping others in a state of bliss. And it's amazing, and yet it's so amazing that it's frightening, and that it frightens me away from bliss. So it's a trick of the ego. It's a trick of the ego when you start thinking, well, wow, how am I going to function? Let's say I was really blissful. How would I function then? It's a trick of the ego to get you to think about that. And when you can say, no, I'm not going to go there at all. I'm just going to, I'm not going to think about how I'm going to function at all. I'm just going to stay within the flow of my life right now. I'm here right now. I'm just staying within that flow. That's it. Then you feel that you're much more stable. So this is very crucial, how we deal with the continuity situation of at least accepting bliss, which is deals with the most difficult continuity issue of all. But we still have a continuity issue accepting bliss. We're afraid that we're going to become a different person and just act in completely different ways. Some of those crazy wisdom, so-called self-described crazy wisdom teachers, I believe they intimidate getting them in trouble and could cause.
They don't really have the great bliss, the great calm. They don't have it. They have the euphoria. They have this ecstasy. They can get into that. But that's still the ego. That's still the ego. And then they act out in all these unsanitary ways. That scares us. We say, oh, God, what if that happens to me? You know, as if it's somehow uncontrollable. The deep calm is just the deep calm. It shouldn't lead to any sort of euphoric behavior.
I would say that the deep calm, what you notice then at that point, would just be that it's there at all times. So you just keep noticing it's here, it's still here, it's still here, it's still here, it's here. But there's no euphoria involved. Okay, like Ramana Maharshi said, the great bliss, the deep bliss, the deep calm is the real goal.
is greater than the ecstasy, the euphoria, that type of what we call, some call that bliss. He says, that's not it. So this is really important, because you didn't see Ramana Maharshi acting out some sort of zany, crazy wisdom, euphoria stuff. No way. He's very calm, deep calm, deeply calm at every moment. That's really the goal. That's the goal. And your functioning remains smooth. What happens is eventually you see that it's the calm is everywhere in all situations, and you then naturally just become much more quieter and less aggressive, and can probably can sit quietly more easily for long periods of time, and others can come with you and sit quietly. And it's not like you become frantic, like you some action. You've got, you're not like you're gonna go crazy and build temples and, you know, evangelize the world and do all this stuff. No. So keep that in mind as far as a continuity issue is concerned, that your life can remain just as it is. But the difference is that you will be noticing your life as it is doesn't touch you, doesn't touch your calm in any way. Your calm is undisturbed by your life as it is, and you just notice that. You just notice it. You say, that's very interesting. The stuff that's happening now is not depleting my energy. It's not touching me. It's not doing anything to me. But you keep up your life as it is. You're just noticing this. And then eventually you realize, well, I really don't need to do all this stuff. But eventually, it's a smooth thing. So what we're really dealing here is with the continuity issue. The continuity problem is all important to deal with it. And we're just looking at it and saying, okay, this sounds very reasonable. And I'm just looking at it with you, just not that I have any set answers at this point. I'm just looking at it because it's important to look at what is it that's holding us back. It's got to be the continuity issue. So how's the continuity issue? What's the fear we have? And then we're afraid of discontinuity. And so then let's look at the goal, which would be the deep calm. And then how can we experience the deep calm without a problem with discontinuity? Without a problem of discontinuity, how can we look at it? And we can see that we just continue on with our life and just notice moment by moment that each one of these moments of our life doesn't touch how we feel at all. And we can still smile and respond the way people expect us to respond, but it's not touching our calm at all. You can still function basically. Sometimes those who are really close get these menial jobs where they really don't have to function very sophisticatedly at all. There's no sophistication in their life. Sophistication is taken out of it for the sake of the continuity issue. Where your interaction with the world is minimal, and so it's easy for you to be in this deep calm and yet function minimally without any problem. Whereas if you're in some real demanding, supervising, managerial, you know, position where you're dealing with so many people and a very intense performance evaluation and everything, then everybody is like looking to you for the slightest nuance of how you might be feeling about this or that, and so your expressions is on the hot seat constantly, and so you might be afraid, oh my God, if I choose a bliss, people might say, well, what's the matter with you? You're not like you usually are. You're not quick on the uptake. You're not all bubbly. You're not, you know, and they'll get worried. So that's a problem. Whereas like in my situation, I can have the personality of a stone and it's really not going to affect my job at all. And so really, if you're in a situation where you're not actually having to be on stage, as it were, in the for the world, as a great blessing. It's a great, great blessing. Maybe you're ill, you can't function so well. Nothing's expected of you. So the continuity problem is not nearly as bad. But if you're like, earning good top money, and you're in a high pressure job, and people are evaluating you, to micromanaging and micro evaluating you, and you of others, etc., then I could see how you would be quite frightened about entering into the deep calm, because others would notice a change in you. Whereas if you, again, have a job where it's just very superficial, go to a cash register, buy stuff, a credit card, slide the credit card, put your PIN, sign, thank you, have a nice day. That's one of the things that I do. And just, there's they're not even paying attention to you. It's very superficial. It's just very formal, civil. Niceties, pleasantries. And if you're calm, that's okay. Say, oh, he's calm, relaxed, nice person. That's it. So again, those who are probably farthest along could very well be in kind of lowly positions in the world. Lowly positions. If you're not in a high position, don't take that as something that means something's wrong with you. It's not true. God's grace, the Holy Spirit, is helping you deal with the continuity problem. So when the deep calm dawns, you don't have to run out and tell everybody. You could. I could make a video on it. I might do that now. Let's see how.
See how it goes. Just pay attention to it and see how it goes. And just get used to it and then gain confidence in it bit by bit. Eventually, once you gain tremendous confidence that it's steady and it's there to stay, then you would be able to work on another level of continuity, as it were. The foundation is there, then you can build a house upon that foundation. But we're only concerned right now about building that foundation. Don't even look ahead about what kind of house am I going to build. Forget it. First, you got to build the foundation, level the lot, dig the foundation, put in the rebar, put in the forms, and then pour the concrete. Got to put in all the foundation, all the all thread for the foundation, to bolt the foundation bolt the framing to the foundation. So we have to do that first. We shouldn't be thinking about the house. Very important. Don't think about what kind of teacher you're going to be. Forget it. Because the only way you're going to get there is to forget about it. And focus more on continuity. And sometimes when you're in public, you have this incredible insight, and you wonder, hey, everybody must be noticing I'm having this great insight. I've had so many insights in public, and I've never once had the impression that anyone has noticed anything whatsoever. I expect it, but I realize everyone's just functioning exactly the way they were before. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Do you have any idea the insight I just had? I mean, basically, I can see how everyone can be free of suffering, and yet they're all just going about their business exactly the same as before. No one has the slightest indication that they're aware that I just had this insight. So I just go, okay.
I'm not going to tell anybody about it. Because, of course, they're concerned with their continuity, too. You see, everyone's concerned with their continuity. So anyone at any time can have the awakening to accept the vision, of the eternal, flawless, perfect, concurrent blessing from the Prime Creator, the blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals by the Prime Creator. I can have that vision right now. It's concurrent. It's the full story. It's the complete picture. Everyone, right this moment, can have a vision of the complete story, the full picture, full story, complete picture of the flawless and perfect, concurrent and eternal blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals by the Prime Creator. There you go. It's all in one sentence. Right now, anyone can have it and continue simply noticing, okay, now I've had this awakening. Okay, now. How does the my situation, my functioning in life, how does that feel? How does that look now? Am I still functioning? Okay. Okay, now what's the next thing? I'm still functioning? Okay. Still functioning? Okay. Doing this? All right. And just like that. Don't worry about anything else other than just doing what you're used to doing. And so nobody would be aware of it. Nobody really know. Unless they're really, you know, you're in some intense relationship where they're looking at you real carefully. I mean, some might notice and you just say, it's just, say, wow, you're in a different mood, huh? Say, well, I'm feeling relaxed, just kind of optimistic. Or you can say, just brush it off, you know. So some may notice, but they don't really know what it is. Say, huh, something's different. Something's different. But you don't have to explain it. Just keep functioning normal. And then they'll just say, oh, okay, you're functioning normal, so it doesn't matter. Everything's fine. What people want is they want continuity, and they want to see others functioning normal around them. So they may notice something different in you, but as long as you're functioning normal and driving well and all that, they say, oh, well, you know, it doesn't matter. Whatever it is, it's okay. It's not affecting, you know, their, you know, continuity. So this is just real practical stuff, and that's the most important. Most important. That's why really mature practitioners, the fast trackers, need to hang out with other fast trackers and not with the slow boaters. Because the slow boaters, if they get a... Where was I? I was somewhere today. And there was a couple of ladies walking out of a store. I was outside. And one of them was very effusive. Big lady, very effusive. Oh my gosh, isn't that wonderful? Oh, it was yesterday. Oh, look, what that smell. Where? Oh, it's coming from the bark. Oh my goodness, it's coming from the bark. Oh my gosh, that's so amazing. Wow, I didn't know it was coming from the bark. I thought it could have been something else. But look, it's coming from the bark. Oh, it's just, oh, isn't that something? Wow. Yeah, gosh. And it going on and on and on and on and on. Just like this very simple thing. And I had noticed the same thing. I had come out earlier. It was actually on Easter Sunday. And I smelled the smell. I said, that's a very good smell. What is that? And then I just instantly, I saw very quickly, it's coming from the bark. And I just kept walking and went to the car. And that's it. That's it. No one had the slightest idea that I smelled this wonderful smell and knew it was the bark, and I just completely kept on moving just like seamlessly, okay. Where this other lady, she might have, you know, could have built an opera around her discovering the smell was coming from the bark. It's just amazing. And that's a slow boater. that's a slow boater. Because they do want to build an opera. They have an insight. And they go, oh my gosh, I got an insight. You can't believe the insight. Oh my gosh. I'm going to write a song. I'm going to write a book of poetry about this. I'm going, hey, how about a production? You know, and it goes on and on and on and on and on. They can't stop talking about this and just reacting to it and all this stuff. No. Have an insight. Say, okay, that's interesting. I see that. Okay. Keep functioning. I say, I know that the context will come later, and it'll come. I'm just, continuity is all important here. Continuity is the number one issue I have, so let me focus on the continuity. Let me not waste time and energy here. I gotta go fast, okay? So what's the next insight? Let's not get hung up on any insight here. Don't even get hung up on enlightenment. Because if enlightenment doesn't resolve the continuity issue, then what's this use? It's useless. So let's make sure that this is dealing with the continuity issue. I can maintain continuity. Let's stick with that. We just assume that we get enlightened. We're gonna print up out thousands of flyers and go out handing them out to everybody. Put them on every, so here, I'm enlightened. Come to my satsang. I'm enlightened. Come to my satsang. No, not necessarily, unless that's the mode that you're used to. There's some people that are natural marketers, and they're used to that. Like Muji was used to, and he was like passing out little, he used to write little sayings, spiritual aphorisms, and go and pass them out with flowers or something in London with, you know, that kind of thing. I'd spend his time doing that. And talking to people all day long. So if someone's in that situation and they're lightened, they can just continue on in the same vein. It's just like they stay in the flow of their life. They don't radically change. So for me, what I'm used to doing is taping and sharing that with people. So I might just continue on in that vein, you know. But maybe the tapings will be very profound or something, I don't know, but so basically you continue on in the same vein that you've been before, and then over time there may be some shifts because your continuity has been built up to such a strong extent that you're able to do something more greater depth and profundity to it. Like Ramana Maharshi was used to sitting, and when the fullness of his realization came, what did he do? He kept sitting. He sat in a cave for a long time, and then eventually he got so used to this, then he came down and began meeting with people. But he was still just doing the same thing, sitting, by and large, just sitting quietly. And on my mom, what was she doing? Well, she was always taking care of her relatives and her husbands and her relatives, cooking for them, cleaning for them, socializing constantly. People are coming and going. And she just continuously did that. And at some point, things dropped away. But she wasn't able to cook or clean anymore. The flow of her life continued normally. Of course, she was always enlightened, but the flow of her life continued smoothly. There was a sense of continuity there. So continuity will be there. That's all important. Of course, we're so tired of our lives. We hope that when we get enlightened, we're going to do something totally different. Oh, man, I dream about that. I hope for that. You know, let me do something completely different. I mean, I want to just, you know, be a completely different person, persona, do things completely differently, have a totally different life. But that's very scary, isn't it? Very scary. So if you're holding that out as that's what's going to happen to your life, then you're going to scare yourself away from it. You're going to scare yourself away from it.
what will probably happen is that when you go to sleep, your dreams will be different. I've experienced that a number of times already. When I was doing the affirmations really strongly, my dreams definitely changed. No question about it. Just entirely different feel to the dreams. So that's another thing, is dreaming is such a big part of sleeping. We spend, 8 hours of our life, which is about a third of the day sleeping. And continuity of our sleeping is also very important to us. So I guess my dreams have been shifting and changing recently, so I can get used to having different dreams, because when you have the deep calm, when you go to bed, the deep calm remains. So your dreams will have a very different feel to them. And you can notice that too. You can notice that too. So again, these are practical things that we're talking about. You can eat the same food. The deep calm will be there. Do the same things. Have the same friends. Have the same life. And eventually, when you realize the deep calm is always going to be with you, then automatically you are able to touch the world, as it were. Ring the bell. You can ring the bell at that point. Because you know no matter what is happening, it's not going to affect it in the slightest bit. So you don't have any concerns about, well, what is it I'm going to do? At that point, your effectiveness can seem to take off, like a plane lifting off of the runway. But first you have to taxi down the runway. You don't just lift off like a helicopter. So really, it's best not to tell anyone of your progress as far as in your immediate, in your life, in your circumstances, of the flow of your life. It's different to tape something like this and to put it out there for those in the world. It feels to me different. But the people that you deal with on a personal basis in your life, it's probably best not to talk about. If you wake up like in bliss and you have this feeling completely suffused with sweetness, it's best not to talk about it, because the people get agitated, they get very frightened, because what they're thinking is you're going to become a totally different person. So that's the last thing they want to hear. So it's best to just notice it and say, okay, this transformation has happened. Okay, what next? Oh, I got to take a shower. Okay, then they take the shower, it's still there. What next? Oh, I got to eat breakfast. Okay, what next? Well, I got to go to work. Okay, go to work. And then, okay, go to work and then come home. Okay, and what next? Oh, let me watch the baseball game. Okay, I'll do that. Eat dinner. And still there, it's still there. Okay, what's next? I'll go to sleep. Okay, do that. And just do that. Just go like that. And they'll notice something is different. People will notice, something is different. But you're functioning the same. So they say, oh, no big deal. Nothing to worry about here. And they'll go about their life. Their life will continue steady too, which is what they want. So that's really, I feel it's very helpful to know that you don't have to open up about it and explain it and get into it with those that that are dependent or used to your functioning in a certain way. But just keep on functioning in that way, and so they don't get alarmed, because people can get very alarmed. Actually, we underestimate how much life is routine. Like our cat, if you don't do the right stuff at the right time, the cat gets frantic. Because the routine isn't there, and they think that you've forgotten them, and they think, oh my gosh, and they may never feed me again ever. They get completely frantic,
And even if there's like kibble over there, the cat says, yeah, but at dinner time, you don't give me kibble, you give me fresh food and treats, and you're not doing it. You're not doing it. And maybe you'll never do it again. And they just, freak out. But then when you stay in the routine, they go, oh, everything's fine. Everything's fine. Okay. No worries. Because you'll be surprised, people don't really, are not interested if you're going to be enlightened or not. They're interested if you're in, are you going to keep functioning the way they're used to you functioning? That's all they care about. That's really all that the world cares about. And if you continue functioning that way, then they say, okay, you're fine, you're okay. You're okay with me. I'm okay with you. And so, no worries. And slowly, change can happen. Change can happen, slowly. But initially, until if you're really totally stable with it, then they can sense that you're very, very stable, and there's no worries. And they say, okay, you can, do what you want to do. I trust. I can see that you're very, very stable, and that's no problem. Because a success will be completely written upon you. You have this, incredible, calm confidence that you cannot fail. It's impossible to fail. You can convey assurance, reassurance, absolutely. No question about it. And I feel like these practical matters are the most important issues to look at. And they're the least looked at, really, in the world. It's kind of like you in contemplation and satsang, you're practicing looking at the panoramic landscape. You say, okay, I see that over there, and I see that, and I see that, and I see that. Okay, and you look again, and say, okay, I see everything's there. I see a little more. Look again, okay, I see a little wider. Okay, everything's still there, a little wider. And you say, okay, I've seen that before, but I also see that, a little bit more over there and there and there too. I've seen this before, but at the foreground and that, I see a little more now, and over here, I've seen that before. And you just say, okay, I've seen that before, but I see a little more. It's just like that. So it's the best satsangs are not like revival meetings are. Some kind of encounter group therapy session where everyone's screaming that, and they suddenly say, "Oh, I just released something! I released it!" Oh my God. Tears and screaming and yelling, and oh, I released it. I'm so happy, and I'm dancing, and all this kind of stuff. I go, whoa, no. Usually, the deeper the insight, the more kind of like quiet you get. But again, don't fake insight through being quiet, trying to make people think that you must be profound because you're quiet. Don't cheat yourself that way. Get the insight. And you'll be quiet just out of necessity, saying, wow, I better be quiet about this one. It's just so, because if I start expressing it, it's going to carry me away. So let me just be real quiet about this. There's a saying, the quiet ones are the smart ones, which is very true. The ones that don't say much of anything at all, they're really, 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 really smart. Because they're seeing so much, they say, wow, if they start commenting, they'll never stop.
It's best just to be quiet. I'm doing these videos because I'm working on the continuity issue of at some point in time needing to share with the world, with others. But I had for a long, long time, I was totally quiet, decades, didn't say anything. Never talked about anything I was doing inside, nothing, no way. I still don't talk about them at all to anyone in my, you know, in my life. No, I don't talk about it. Don't say anything. Just function the way they expect me to function, that's it. Break up the leaves, water the plants, cut the dead foliage, dig out the trash, make the dinner, make the food, do the shopping, do whatever, you know, just do what you're, you know, expected to do. And of course, said before, that what is the trigger for enlightenment? There is no trigger. There is no trigger. That's the trigger. Dwelling on those kind of paradoxical statements is super helpful. The trigger is that there is no trigger. It's like a Zen koan, you know, focusing on that. The trigger is that there is no trigger. And the insights that make you feel like a little different. It kind of stops, the mind kind of stops like that. It's just like, wow. Those are the real beneficial situations. Where your mind just is not trying to figure anything out. It's just like, wow. I accept that. The trigger is that there is no trigger. What I'm experiencing is really no thinking, hardly any thinking at all. Thinking slows way down and it almost stops. So we can practice being in that condition. And get used to that, so there's continuity there. That's what the Zen koan is for, is to stop thoughts, so you get used to not having a bunch of thoughts. Of course, in the deep calm, there are infinite thoughts taking place, but they're not touching the deep calm at all, not disturbing it. It's just like on the surface, there are infinite, you know, ripples on the surface of the ocean, but beneath the surface, there's no ripples at all there, see? It's like that. So to practice just abiding in no thought. Now, it's not that deep calm. There's still ripples, but it seems way, way dampened down. Way dampened down. Trigger is that there is no trigger. And so, since there's no trigger, why do we need to keep looking for a trigger? Since we don't need to keep looking for a trigger, why do we need thinking to try and locate the trigger? Why do we need a search? What's the way to get into happiness? The way to get in is except there is no way to get in. There is no trigger. So you stop searching for the way to get in, and then you find that you've always been there. You're there. Because the searching takes place in time, because it implies that you don't have it yet, right? So if you don't have something yet, what does that do? Automatically brings time into the picture, doesn't it, to find it? Remember, God's unconditional non-judgment of all hypotheticals is here now. It's concurrent. So it can only be found in its flawless, seamless perfection, as it's always been. Seamless, not compound. So time couldn't possibly have been involved with it at all. It's not time-based. It's not time-based. So we don't need to search for it. The search implies that it's time-based. So when people say, is there an answer? They're saying, is there a time-based answer? So the answer is, there is no time-based answer. Is it thought-based, meaning time-based thoughts? Thinking, time-based thinking. Is there some way to locate it? Does thinking, can thinking find it? No. It is found by not being found. See, these are the paradoxical statements that tend to, you know, bring us closer to a full stop. By not finding, we find. You've heard those, you know, those kind of paradoxical statements. Well, the idea is, don't try to figure it out. It's to accept it and to see that's the answer. And so just abide in that answer. That is the answer. In other words, giving up, realizing it's not in time. You can't find it. You find it by realizing you can't find it. I mean, you can't find it in time. So you stop searching in time, and then you find it right now. That's interesting. Meditation comes out of that, and it seems possible to remain in that condition. It seems as though meditation can work, but it can also not work. It depends on why are you abiding in the stillness of mind. Is it to accept that the deep calm, the unconditional non-judgment upon all hypotheticals by the Prime Creator, or is it to try and be calmer when you attempt to search in time to bring about more profound effects in time? See, that's the question. Why are you trying to abide in this calmness meditation? Not all meditators reach enlightenment. I've noticed that. A lot of them tend to talk about how wonderful it is that they're able to function more effectively in the world, get more done after meditation. So, see, that's a different purpose. But I saw how it's possible, it is possible to get in this condition where you're not thinking so much at all. The mind is quieted down, and just to stay in that, just stay in that. That is possible. Absolutely is possible. I was just doing it there, so. I've never tried to do that, because it shouldn't be an end in itself. It somehow has to be put in the right context. Okay, well, very tired today. Wow, as always. So it's important that when these moments of quietness where your mind stops, pretty much stops, you say the trigger for enlightenment is there is no trigger. Your mind stops to just hang out with that. Just hang out with it like that. Don't have to talk or explain all the time or read all the time. So affirmations are very helpful. If you can get an affirmation that then stops your mind like that, and then just abide in that stopped mind condition, relatively so, it's muted, let's say muted mind, then you just say, okay, my mind is muted now, just observe it. Okay, my mind is muted, let's just observe this. Not trying to do anything with it necessarily, just observing it. Okay, muted mind, just become familiar with it. Become familiar with the majority of your thoughts having dropped away. Considerations, calculations, measurements, memories of measurements. Memories of searches. We're searching for the answer in time. Which is really an affirmation we're making that God is unstable, that is not fixed, God's will is not fixed. That reality can be changed. That's actually what we're asserting when we're in time at all, focusing on time at all. When we're not making any search, we don't need much thought, do we? If you're sitting there on a bench and you don't need to go anywhere or do anything or eat any food or talk to anyone, do anything at all, just sitting there, why do you need a bunch of thoughts? Maybe you want to imagine something. You'll imagine something so you don't get bored or whatever. But as far as feeling no demands upon your time whatsoever, you'll find that your mind gets a lot quieter. But when you entertain a seemingly paradoxical truth, the answer is that there is no answer. The trigger is that there is no trigger. and you really allow that to grip you, is a different different kind of quietness. It's kind of like a wow type of quietness, like wow, I didn't know my mind could be so stopped like that, like that. Wow, that's amazing. A different kind of quiet. It's not a bored quietness. It's not a fatigued quietness. It's a wow quietness. Wow quietness. And of course, the bliss, the great calm, belongs to us. So we say, I seek only what belongs to me in truth. And this blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals does belong to me in truth, because of the prime creator that gave the blessing. And everything that the prime creator, everything of the prime creator, belongs to us too. It belongs to all reality. So it's a mutedness. It's like you're turning down the radio, and it's still there. I still hear the theme for the Love Boat going on in my mind, but it's much, much quieter, like distant. And I believe that's pretty much like when you're entering into the great clarity, the bliss, the great quiet, the great calm. Is that the world? Everything is still there. But it's like at a great distance, and it's very muted. I saw a picture of like the world was all in front of me, but between me and the world was like this cotton candy or something. It's like this pink floss candy, like insulation or something, where everything in the world was happening, but it was so muted that I wasn't feeling the impact of anything at all by myself. But I could look and I could see that all these forms are dancing and doing all their stuff, and you know, politicking and socializing. It's just this mad whirl of existence that's going on the surface. It's all going on, but I'm not getting impacted by it in any way, because I'm just sort of abiding in this soft, fluffy, cushiony, gentle insulation, cotton candy, like that just mutes it all to this, you know, totally muting it. I guess cotton candy would also be very sweet. That's how I saw it. So this theme from the Love Boat, when my mind slowed down and was muted, it was way, way, way in the background. Now it's coming back up to the foreground. The volume is coming back up on it. So don't destroy, kill the world. Mute the world. Mute it. So you can see everything that's still going on and still function normally. It's just it's not making any impact on you. And you feel just this very sweet calmness. Bliss. You experience bliss. And that's what we want now, because, of course, the world is going to become incredibly hectic. If it isn't already, compared to what it used to be, it's incredibly hectic, but it's a quantum progression we're on. It's very important to understand that. We're not on a linear type of progression, we're on a quantum progression. Just like what is it, every couple of years, the capacity of memory doubles or something. That's whose law is that? It's some, whatever. It's a law of, was it Intel, the guy that at Intel, Gordon Baker or something, Gordon Baker's law, something like that, Gordon's law, but it's quantum. So the hecticness of the world is going off the charts. It's quantum. It's going quantum. And the only thing that deals with that is this deep calm, is enlightenment. The only thing that deals with this situation properly. Otherwise, the impact is going to be too much. And what has happened is you end up fragmenting to try and avoid too much impact on you. And then when you end up fragmenting, you end up becoming a moron, basically. The world is full of morons right now. It's all fragmented. They're superficial. If you try to keep your depth in this world and the wholeness and depth without the deep calm, you're going to be totally stressed out. Totally stressed out. Way overburdened. It's becoming impossible with this quantum hecticness going on. So you're either going to dumb yourself down to an extreme extent, or you're going to be enlightened. And the amazing thing is, if you give a break to your sadhana spiritual practice, you very quickly find out you're dumbing yourself down really fast, real fast. And that's the scary part. That's what I've noticed. Sometimes I'll give myself like a two-minute break or something, and I say, there's all this storyline starts emerging, imaginings and feelings on the. And I realize I'm being pulled down into death and fragmentation and stupidity and all that super fast. Whoosh. So, wow, that's way faster than it used to be. Are you kidding? Wow. That's true. That's what's happening right now.
Trying to get this other Ustream thing working here. Hopefully it'll get back. Well, the audio's hopefully still there. No, it's not. I don't know. Is it still any audio? Any audio? No. One, two. All right, there's audio. Is there any video? It jumps around. Why? Anyway, this is a great experiment, but it's not working out so great. There you go. There's some video there on the Ustream. I'm Ustream recording. Well, we'll see. So keep your spiritual practice uninterrupted as much as possible. The scary part of the times is the decline can happen within a minute so fast. Wow. That should be, you know, alarm bell should go off. I've struggled with this because it's hard to believe. You say, wait a minute, this isn't right. I can at least have 10 minutes. I used to be able to have an hour or two or a day, or not a day, but you know, a couple hours I can take a break. And now you just really can't take a break. You can't let your mind be grabbed by the world at this point, because you start to deteriorate almost instantly. And the deterioration is incredible. You find your mind going into all this death-based stuff, super fast, vicious stuff. You know, all the stuff that's in the news, all the criminal stuff, the violent stuff, the tragic stuff, the death-based stuff. And your scenario will build up, and it can start innocently. You know, I got my eye here.
It just seems like you just start thinking about some innocent kind of thing, imagining, and then you imagine a scenario with that, and then before you know it, boom, you're into this death-based kind of stuff. So you got to be very careful about imagining stuff right now. It's better to stay away from it, which is why affirmations are helpful. You start to get into anything and say, now is concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. God's eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals solves the continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. And the continuity problem. And I choose to see the full story right now. So when you start imagining, saying, I choose to see the full story right now, you have to catch yourself. I choose to feel see the full story right now. You need some affirmation that you can catch yourself when you start imagining, because as you are obviously, people are noticing that when you start trying to imagine things, it can be something like, for instance, you start imagining something, you notice something, and you say, hey, I could write a screenplay, a script about that. And you start imagining, what kind of movie could I make about that? And the screenplay, and then you think, oh, I could really have these great scenes here and then do this. And then before you know it, the movie starts getting kind of violent and weird and scary and stuff. You say, whoa, I don't want that movie. Well, you know, what's happening? The world is in such a bad vibe right now that the descent is super fast, super fast. In other words, when you tune into the vibes of the world mind, it's incredibly dark right now. Incredibly dark. And the darkness comes upon you in a big hurry. And you think, hey, that's weird. You know, a while ago, it wasn't that fast. I could imagine a brilliant movie scenario, and it stayed really light and wonderful for, you know, 20 minutes. And then it started getting kind of twisted and weird. But now it gets twisted and weird like in 3 minutes. You think, what's wrong with me? Maybe I'm slipping. No, you're not slipping. The world is getting worse. It's going into this quantum phase now. And it's getting more hectic, and it's more fragmenting, and you find yourself needing to compartmentalize yourself and trivialize your life and yourself, and enter into this moronic condition. It can happen with alarming speed. And then when it happens, just notice it and say, okay, I'm noticing that. Okay. That was fast. Okay, let's go back. Now I was concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. I accept the vision of the full story right now. The continuity problem has always been solved. God's perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Solved it concurrently. And that's here right now for me. And I'm seeing it. I'm accepting the vision of this concurrent non-judgment of all hypotheticals right now. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of God is mine. Just go back to your affirmations, and that pulls you out of the darkness like that. But very disturbing how quickly one descends now. Very disturbing. Which is why at this point only those who are really going for it and have the capacity to make these affirmations and switch their mind back to contemplation are going to succeed, because the others are going to be fragmented and to try and deal with the stress. And people literally fragment themselves into future lives that way, because they don't feel the wholeness, totality of their life now. They're only feeling this small little part of it that has just a little small, you know, has blinders on and doesn't really see the total hecticness that's going on. And then they've got all sorts of fragments that they project into time as if they weren't whole, not all one, but are different people, and then they end up experiencing, you know, those different fragments and oh, dropped out again. So anyway,
that is true. So those who are going towards enlightenment, though, they won't do that. They want to keep this total integrity going, but we're going to have to shift into the deep calm. We're going to have to do it. There's no way around it right now. There's no way around it. And we're surrounded by morons in the world. We're surrounded by fragmentation. And everybody's saying, hey, this is normal, don't worry. Well, it's normal if you want to have a whole bunch of other lives. But if you don't, then it's not normal for you or good for you at all. So you have to now use the affirmations. Stop your descent into that darkness quickly. Quickly. Don't say, well, I should be able to deal with this in an hour or two, or I can deal with it real slowly. No, deal with it fast. Real fast. Now is concurrent with time. God's perfect non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. God's perfect non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. God's perfect non-judgment is mine. See, that brings you full integrity, full wholeness, clarity, and your intent is right there, centers you, boom, like that, and you're no longer, the dark thoughts, gone. Yeah, you know, we're just curious sometimes about how dark the world is. Sometimes I'll let my mind ascend into the vibe, mindset of the world, the mental body of the world, just to see what it's like. I say, how bad is it? And I'll come away shocked, really shocked. Holy smokes. It's gruesome. It's really gruesome. The world is in an extraordinarily gruesome condition. It's not just violent, it is gruesome. And I just say, whew. That's not good. Yeah, the mental body, the world mind is in such a bad place right now. Holy cow. But we have the remedy. We have the remedy, and we will employ the remedy. Keep employing the remedy continuously, you see, as I keep on recording this video. And hopefully the audio came through. I don't know. I got my doubts. But let's find out. I'm interested in finding out that that fact, and I don't have to plunge my mind into the world mind to figure that, to experience this. Okay, so as always, I'm happy with the video because it gets into the nitty gritty, and the nitty gritty is not glamorous. But it's effective. It's helpful. So continue on again. And don't let your mind start descending into the world mind. Say, no. Bring it back. Keep it here. It's possible to do that. Very possible. I got to do a better job myself, too. All right. Very great. That's it. See how this turned out.